From Paul's letter to the Romans. Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Jesus was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in the newness of life. Good morning, brothers and sisters. Welcome to Hancock United Methodist Church. We're excited to worship with you today. There are just a couple of announcements. The first is that the youth will be meeting on Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, and they're gonna be carting pumpkins. So that'll be a fun night of fellowship for our youth. And then we are still taking orders for our soup and sandwich fundraiser. So I invite you to take a look at your bulletins and check out the details for that. We're raising money to pave our parking lots. We are beginning a new worship series this week, Living Out Our Baptism. How do we live our baptism? And we're gonna explore what that journey in discipleship looks like over the next 7 weeks. And it will culminate with a renewal of our baptismal vows and our membership promises, and we will receive into membership new members on November 15th. So I invite you to journey with us as we live our baptism. Let us prepare our hearts for worship. Please light the candle in your worship space as a reminder of God's divine presence with us. Let us pray. Oh, holy God, we thank you. We thank you for this day where we can come together and worship you, where we are reminded that we are reconciled to you through Jesus's death and resurrection. It is only by your grace, God, that we have been redeemed and renewed, created anew, created to be what you have called us to be. God, we praise you, we worship you, and we ask that all that we do honor you. Amen. Please stand as you're able and join us in our opening hymn, Victory in Jesus.
His groaning of his precious blood's atoning, then I
As we prepare to hear the Word of God, I invite you to turn in your Bibles to the Gospel of John, chapter 3. And we'll be reading the first 8 verses from the Gospel of John. But while you're also in your Bibles, I invite you to mark the page in your Bible for Acts, chapter 2, beginning at verse 37, because we will be reading 2 passages of Scripture today as we explore how we live our baptism. You see, the New Testament has much to say about baptism. We read of Jesus being baptized by John in the Jordan River in the Gospel of Matthew, and later in that same Gospel, he commands his disciples to teach and baptize in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Baptism is grounded in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And the grace which baptism makes available to us is that of the atonement of Christ, which makes possible our reconciliation with God. You see, baptism involves dying to sin, newness of life, union with Christ, receiving the Holy Spirit, and incorporation into Christ's church. As members of a local church, as members of Hancock United Methodist Church, we promise in our membership vows to faithfully participate in the ministries by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness. Therefore, our membership in a local church means more than belonging to a social club or just having your name on the books. Our membership vows connect the promises that began with our baptisms and extends into our everyday lives as we live as disciples of Christ. In this 7-week series titled Living Our Baptism, we are invited to refresh our spiritual discipleship, to refresh that spirit as we explore 5 means of grace: prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness. But let us first explore baptism. So please turn in your Bibles to the Gospel of John, chapter 3, and hear these words inspired. These words that are divinely inspired and written in the Gospel of John. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God." Jesus answered him, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." Nicodemus said to him, How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of flesh is flesh. What is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I have said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. This is our gospel lesson today. And in this gospel lesson, we hear a dialogue between Jesus and Nicodemus about being born of water and the Spirit, about being born from above. It is a dialogue about salvation. It is about being born again. It is a dialogue about the Holy Spirit working in us and transforming us. Water is a symbol of the cleansing power and the transforming power of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Through the waters of baptism, we are cleansed of our sin and born into a new way of living. Whether an infant or adult, this is just the beginning. To be born again is for the Holy Spirit to come and dwell in us, to cleanse us of our sins and to completely transform us from the inside out through faith in Christ Jesus. Our whole life is changed. The old has gone and the new has come. We are born again or made new. Newness of life through our union with Christ Jesus. In baptism, we reject the power of sin and begin our journey as disciples of Jesus Christ. You see, baptism starts that process of breaking us away from sin's power, but it is the sanctifying grace of God throughout our lives that actually accomplishes that. Baptism involves dying to sin, newness of life, union with Christ, receiving the Holy Spirit, and also incorporation into Christ's church. Incorporation into Christ's church. What does that look like? I invite you to turn in your Bibles to Acts chapter 2, and we're going to begin with verse 37. As we read of the first converts, the first followers of Jesus, the first church. Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and to the other apostles, Brothers, what should we do? Peter said to them, Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, so that your sins may be forgiven and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you, for your children, for all who are far away, everyone whom the Lord God calls to him. And he testified with many other arguments and exhorted them, saying, Save yourselves from this corrupt generation. So those who welcomed his message were baptized. And that day about 3,000 persons were added. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayers. You see, the first followers, they were baptized, but it didn't end with that ritual of baptism. The sacrament, the experiencing of God's grace here and now in baptism continued. And it continued with study, with fellowship, with communion and prayer. It continued with a journey of discipleship within a community of believers. One of the gifts of that the Holy Spirit gives us is the church, local and universal, into which the sacrament of holy baptism initiates us. In the ritual act of baptism, we, the congregation, take vows to surround the person being baptized with a community of love and forgiveness, and to pray for that individual that they may be a disciple of Jesus Christ, whom walks in the way that leads to life. We reaffirm our own faith and commitment. And then we promise to nurture and teach and support those whose commitments are being affirmed. We need mutual nurturing, both by proclamation and by example. We grow in faith, service, and discipleship within a community of love and forgiveness. In baptism, we welcome our newest members and renew our covenant to live a life of discipleship. Baptism is not an act that imparts something just to the person being baptized. It is an act that brings into spiritual relationship the whole body of Christ, one in which we become one in Christ, one in the Spirit. Christianity is not lived out in isolation, but in community with other Christians. Together, the baptized, the church of all ages, nations, and races, walk in the way that leads to life. Once we have been claimed by God's love, adopted by God's grace, and initiated into the body of Christ, God never fails to remain faithful to the divine side of the new covenant. It is the human side of the covenant which is neglected, and even broken. Our journeys of faith are not a steadily ascending march to spiritual heights, but a back and forth and up and down. It's a process. We take a few steps forward, we take a few steps back. It's a bumpy road. We need intentional opportunities to renew our trust in Christ and to recommit ourselves to Christian discipleship. As we continue this worship series, we will have intentional opportunities to renew our trust in Christ and to recommit ourselves to Christian discipleship. We will have opportunities to support the ministries of God's church through our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness. Will you please pray with me? Gracious, loving, forgiving God, we thank you for your gifts. We thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit who indwells within us, that transforms us, that renews us, and makes us new. God, we thank you for this community of believers who support and nurture and teach and guide and love us. Love us despite our sins and our failings. God, we thank you. We thank you for your faithfulness today and forevermore. Amen. We now move into a time of joyful giving. This is an opportunity where we give of ourselves, where we give of our time, our talents, our tithes, our whole beings. I invite you to reflect on the grace of God during this musical offering.
Grace my fears, renewed. How precious!
now come to God and offer our joyful gifts. God, our Heavenly Father, you welcome us as sons and daughters through baptism in Christ. Your Holy Spirit lives in our hearts and burns away what is not pleasing to you. Just as Jesus turned to you in prayer, help us to seek your will continually. May our offerings support the work of this church, lifting up hope and new life in our community through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We now move into a time of prayer where we share our prayer concerns with one another. I invite you to email me during the week so that we can add your requests to our list of those that we are covering in prayer. For this week, I invite you to pray for Janet Henderson, who is having some back trouble. I invite you to pray for Lisa Hendershot, who is preparing to have carpal tunnel surgery. I invite you to pray for John Newbrough, who is having many, many health issues. I invite you to pray for Eloise Alis, Talmadge Stewart's cousin, who has been diagnosed with cancer. We continue to pray for Dottie and Pam, for Rose Custer's sister, Philly, for Cindy Panisi, Donna Gaither, Donnie Corbett, Debbie Cohill's brother, Richard, Mark McKee, Linda Northcraft, Linda and Donnie Sowers, Phyllis Douglas, Tina Goodwin, Destiny Goodwin, Wayne Freeland, Ramona Creek, Bill Willison and his wife Carol, Stephanie Shives, Kenneth McFadden, David Danfelt, those that are impacted by layoffs and downsizing. We invite you to continue to lift those families that are grieving loss. In the last week, we have lost two of our brothers and sisters in Christ. So I invite you to continue to pray for Norman Trail's family as they grieve his loss, and for Faye Yonker's family who grieves her loss. We are excited to share with you that Talmadge Stewart has been moved out of the hospital and is now in a rehabilitation facility. And when I talked to him this week, he was doing very well and getting stronger. And he wanted me to share with you that he has felt our prayers. So I invite you, brothers and sisters, to continue to lift each other and to lift those that we have named in prayer. Let us go to God in prayer. God, we come to you with those that we have named. You know what the needs are. You know where the healing is necessary, that restoration to wholeness, be it in mind, body, or spirit. God, we lift to you also those unspoken requests. We lift to you those who are so private that they're unable to share the things that are on their hearts. But God, you know, and we ask that those unspoken requests be placed before you. God, we pray for comfort and peace for the family and friends of Norman and Faye as they grieve this fresh loss. But there is hope. There is hope because Jesus died on the cross. We know that there is eternal life and there is hope in you. God, we also lift those who are grieving losses that have occurred last year, the year before, 6, 7, 8, 9, 20 years ago, those losses are still felt. God, we pray comfort. We pray peace. We pray your hope among those that are grieving. God, we pray for our country as we enter into this time of elections where there is such strife and such ugliness. God, we ask that your church model reconciliation, that your church model grace and kindness and love. God, be with our world leaders, our nation's leaders, our state and local leaders. Be with them, God. God, we ask that you be with your church. Open our hearts, transform us anew. Let us recommit ourselves to you. And in doing so, as a community of faith, let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. I invite you to stand as you're able in your space and join us in singing Made New.
You're calling me over. You're pulling me close. With love you surround me. You give me hope. Yeah. You're taking me deeper. You're making me whole. With grace you redeem me, yeah. You restore my soul. Now I'm made new because of you. Yeah, you hold my head up. You remind me who I am. You hold my head up. I'm alive in you again. I'm made new. I made new. You hold my head up. You hold my head up.
As we get ready to go out into the world, I bid you this blessing. May the waters of God's grace surround you and uphold you. May your baptism strengthen you for the work ahead. And may the Spirit descend upon you, the same Spirit that descended upon Jesus at his baptism. May that Spirit fall upon your shoulders as you seek to do God's will. Amen.